Birch Hellman, legendary pan tuner, and an unstandard player in your own right. And we're taking the opportunity to touch base with you as you are in New York in Sinatra's pan yard. And welcome to Wednesday's Oaks.
Thank you.
Okay. Maybe what I should start with is, tell us a bit about yourself, your history, how you got involved in pan tuning as a young person, and also take time to share with us your history as a pan player.
Okay, well, it all started as the vibe just liking music on the whole, not even music alone. It started way back in the 60s in Marbella. I played with Southern Marines, and after I moved on to the, as a representative with the National Steel Band, a representative of Southern Marines to the National Steel Band. I stayed in there for quite some time. I played, I think that was about the amount of playing I did with two bands, that's the National Steel Band and Southern Marines. After I started to do some individual playing, I would call myself a mediocre soloist, not great like the Sharp and the Greenwich and them. Being able to help myself to do a little arranging for about two or three bands, and after on to the massive band tuning.
Which
of
the bands you arranged for about
those years? Alright, that was in about 68, 69, Southern Marines. I did some work for another band named Scarlet Symphony, and I think that was about it. Yeah.
Did you enjoy your days as a player and also as an arranger?
I loved it as a player, but was really just inquisitive, really wanting to find out. I think I can make this pan song better, so the playing days was quite short, really, really quite short, you know. Being inquisitive as a young person, all the energy, wanting, you know, to, I feel I can make the song better, and that's how I started with the tune.
Do you miss playing at all?
Yeah.
Ever play?
Yeah, I am.
Besides just checking up on your.
Just check. Alright, that's the highlight of my playing. Just as I finish makeup and, you know, I could demonstrate it for a potential buyer. I could demonstrate it.
Take us through the tuning process.
Okay, well, with me at that time, it started with some old. Most likely stolen drum, you know, and well, the processes, we get down, we get it synced to reasonable depth, we do some marking on it, we just started to counter-sync the preparation, we groove it, we do some burning, we groove it, after we groove it, we raise the notes, do some burning, soften up, and then we get down to the actually rough tuning. Tune it, rough tune it, send it to the comb, back from the comb, we get down to some tuning again, and then the fine tuning.
You're here to do some tuning today, and yeah. I see that you have some of your work implements. Do you want to just share a few words as to the functions of...
Alright, well, yeah. What I use this for is like, I back out like notes, sometimes probably I might be getting problem with a certain note, I use it to raise back the notes, which is the rubber side, well, this side, I use it like for flat bonging, so that it will leave no marks, and this, I actually do the tuning with this. Oh, this is something which we call a strobe, a Peterson 590. It really actually, you know, I look for harmonics, the upper partial, the different stuff with this piece of equipment.
How has tuning changed as far as you've experienced as a young person years ago to now?
To know the technology is just great. This is something, it's precision now. It's not I pong and think I might get a note, you know. I think it's precision. There are a lot of other big tuners out here doing a lot of research, and it's helped for all of the rest of tuners that's in the Caribbean. Like the one person we call, I don't know if it's all right, it's Ellie Manatee. You could learn a whole lot from this guy, you know. He made it a science.
What differences, if any, are involved when you tune the different types of tenors? You have the tenors, the guitars, your basses, tenor basses. Is there a difference in the technique, or is it?
All right, there are differences with like the basses. Like at one time people had me carded as probably in the world as one of the best bass tuners, you know. And I think there are a lot of techniques I use, like especially with bass pans, midline pans, cello pans, tenor basses, to get my pans out. I don't know what other people use, but they are a whole lot different, like the process they use in tuning a guitar pan is something different you will do on a tenor pan, as well as the bass pans. Alright, well, the bass we sink much shallower. You know, it looks very simple, as that's why the majority of young tuner, everybody run to see if they could tune a bass. It looks much more simple, but I think it's the same amount of work. It's sunk much shallower. You haven't got much lines to groove on, but like to get these bass notes all clean, it takes a lot of time and a lot of technique. Yeah, well, back in Trinidad, I work like for Renegades. Phase 2, Skiffle Bunch. Okay, the New York bands. Well, recently I started to do some work for them, so I started to do some work for Moods. For 2003, them stars and Sonatas, I did some work for
a lot of bands.
All right, well, I give it a 5 days.
Do you know
this other band? Yeah, to get down 5 days and probably about 3 nights. You know how to define. Yeah,
more like 8 days.
Yeah, 8 days, if I go wrong with
And just for the sake of the listening audience, tell us approximately how many fans that a band like Sonatas would have if you would do this kind of thing.
Okay, I probably might do about 25 tenors. I do about 5 pairs of double tenors, about 8 pairs of double seconds, midline like cellos, probably about 7 or 8 cellos, and in the basses, about 14 sets of basses.
What dictates the time when fans are
okay, it's you practically answer half the question for me. It's dependent on how the pans are playing, much how the pans are maintained. Understand? Because if you have something, you don't clean it, you don't maintain it, I think the building of the actually building of the pan in the first instance, if it isn't built properly, you gotta keep checking it all the time.
What difference is this, or what impact has it produced, if any, that the weather in New York, North America has, as opposed to that warmer climate, the impact it has on the pan?
Alright, the impact it has is that, like, storage. If you don't store your pans proper, you'll be. It look all combed on top, and you'll be running into a lot of problems in the rim and the seam of the pan, the moisture form there, and a lot of rust. If you don't check that, you could be in a whole lot of trouble with that.
Do you find that young people are interested in acquiring the skill? Do they come to you and say, your teachers have to do this? Any real interest?
Not much. they come to me, the preparation of Apan, Atenapan, my in Trinidad, Atenapan, it costs about probably about $700-$800. Somebody who prepare Atenapan will charge you to do that.
Just
to prepare the pan. So you find they come and they prepare and they leave. They're not much interested in the tuning. Because I have a guy, he's with me probably for about 13, 14 years, and he's interested in preparing that tuning.
So how do we pass on the skill?
Okay, we pass on the skill, hopefully. How it happened to me that out there, the million of people, I think there are 2 or 3, it will always be a very, very small tuner market. Yeah, 13, 14 years. I'm trying to get him to tune now, but he's interested in preparing, because if he prepares, he do 6 pans for the week, he's alright, you know.
What are the differences that you personally
have noticed
between
the Trinidad Steel Band World and New York Steel Band World? Okay, I think, alright, I think the New York Steel Band World, I think they're too relaxed. They remind me, they have everything, they have all the resources and everything to move forward, to have a well-equipped, well-good-looking steel band. They remind me Parang, something we have Parang in Trinidad. They pull out the cutlery, they set off 3 months before Panama, and they get going. You don't get anywhere there, you know. This is not no part-time lover. This is full-time. When you see the typical
year, meaning the time, I assume you work throughout the year.
Right, true.
What is a typical year for you? Meaning you work with, you have a lot of work with the
Trinidad, the Antigua, yes. Okay, I work, do a lot of work in Grenada, Antigua. Plenty work in Antigua, do work in St. Thomas, do some work in Japan, do some work in France. Do some work in England, so more or less that. Yeah, do some work. I work with Mangrove in England. I work with Ebony in England.
Some of the Japanese.
Oh, I can't remember the names. You know, I can't really. You know. Yeah, Geminites. I work for Geminites. That's my favorite band, and I work for Harmonites too. Antigua, Ebonites, the letter Knights, you know.
What thoughts would you like to share with the steel band community? Anything you personally think that needs to be said, isn't said, or people don't know about? It could be about the steel band world in general. What are your thoughts?
I think the thoughts I would like to leave is that we need to get more young people involved with this somewhere. There are people who could encourage them to try to at least make a band. There are a lot of players. Some of them come to play genuinely, and some come to play to get away from the mother and father house for the evening, you know. But I would like to encourage the people who really in charge of culture to help along with the tuning, in getting a lot of young people involved with it.
Have you noticed any differences in the technique employed in players, you know, years gone by, and people who came back to me?
Yeah. I think they are more flamboyant today. They're more skillful, you know, and they do a show for you and you get music with the show. Whereas in my time, we concentrate on a good playing, who could hold the best, and you know, everybody's old, so, yeah.
Do you think maybe that those things need a bit more attention in today's players?
Yeah, technique. Really learning to roll proper and, you know, hand lip and be able to, because probably I might coast a pan and a young person might come, they sound feeble, but when they go to actually play the Panama tune, they will play that. But they doesn't know anything again after that. You know, it comes in there. This is something I think we need to really learn other skills. Music, I forget to put that down. We need to, that's one of my thoughts, like getting around to people, making sure that that player, that individual player, boy or girl, you know, learn to read their music and understand what they are doing. Not, I did it by ear, and I have a whole lot of stuff that I did when you really check a music store. It sounded good to me, but it was so wrong.
Thank you so very much for sharing time with the Wednesday folks, and look forward to hearing more from you, hearing that more people are coming to you and saying you want to, you know, learn this really important skill. Thank you very much again.
You're welcome. Thank you.